procedures. There's not many simple neurosurgical procedures. They're all very complex procedures. Patients have been in hospital for a long time, may take a long time to rehabilitate. It's to be dislocated from your family for perhaps numbers of weeks on end, we feel, again, is totally undesirable. We agree the way it will be proposed must be safe and must be sustainable. I would make the point that the league has for the last 67 years to do it safe and sustainable neurosurgery, and that is what action will continue. So what we're proposing is what we are proposing is a very collaborative one, and we think with goodwill, and I say that we do collaborate in a number of clinical areas with our neighbouring DHBs, and so with goodwill we believe it's not only possible but desirable to do so. The effects of losing neurosurgery can be well covered in the Otago Daily Times, and certainly people with much more expertise and various skills than I have made some very good points. But just let me summarise, and it's hard to say this without sounding overtly dramatic. With the loss of neurosurgery, people will die. A very small number, but how much is a very small number to justify moving a service? But also there's many other things, and when we think of neurosurgery, think about boring holes in people's ear and any other blood clots. Well, in actual fact, it's much more than that in terms of an acute treatment. A lot of the closed and injuries we have coming in around intensive care and requires neurosurgical input. There's lots of monitoring devices we put on the people that are best placed by neurosurgeons. We have patients with acute spinal problems. Perhaps some patients with advanced cancer have had tumours that are compressing their spine, and they require very, very urgent, with an hour or so decompression of that. Failure to do that means that instead of spending perhaps the last few months or years or so of life mobile and in comfort, they need to be confined to a wheelchair bed with a paraplegia and tetraplegia. So there are a number of things over and above the acute dramatic taking off the theatre that occurs. But I want to touch a little bit on what Brian Rousseau has just said, that neurosurgery doesn't exist in isolation. Healthcare today is a very, very complex thing. There's interaction, a series of interactions, a lot of different specialties. And so you just can't take on specialty out of isolation and expect no untoward effects with the healthcare that we can provide. If you have no neurosurgery, you cannot look after as well in the intensive care with your head injury. Our neurological service is compromised because today's needs and the distinction between surgeons and physicians become very blurred. And so you need both to have an effective team. Our orthopedic and spinal surgeons often collaborate with the neurosurgeons for the operations they do compared to our ENT surgeons. The rehabilitation centers that we have are very dependent on the presence of neurosurgery. Our ability to train, particularly anesthetic doctors and neurosurgical anesthesia is very much affected. And the medical school that also Brian has mentioned is affected because we haven't got academic and neurosurgery. We have difficulty in attracting other academics and fields that are related to us. And so there's a whole bunch of downward effects that show that neurosurgery does not exist in isolation. There's a financial burden, there's no doubt a financial burden to DHB. DHB has to pay for procedures to be locally, patient travel expenses, the rehabilitation expenses, and also the non-neurosurgical patient that would have been operated in Dunedin, the lungs with complex spinal conditions and such like, would also have to travel. And then there's an emotional burden to the community with dislocation of families, the time when families need to be most together. There's another phenomenon too that's been touched on tonight, it's the who next phenomenon. There is no doubt a philosophy in central government right now to centralise services. And if you've been in healthcare long enough, things go on cycles. 20 years ago, it was thought we could devolve services to groups of 20,000 people. Now we're certainly back to the centralist model. And so this can be done with neurosurgery. What next? Things that I do, for example, may disappear. I've got no desire, certainly, to move north. And so what I think is that we need to resist to the degree, not the selfish, not the centric view that currently exists with regard to neurosurgery. We believe the 4-2 model is safe and sustainable. We see it as part of the collaborative regional service, and it best suits the needs of the South Island. Now, being no doubt that neurosurgery leaves the need of the 300,000 people that the DHB represents, will have compromised clinical safety, will have reduced the level of service, it will be an increased financial cost. And to me, that defies logic.